Good evening, everyone. Welcome, and thank you for joining Our Power's 2021 Clean Energy Summit. Our Power is a group of Maine ratepayers, business leaders, energy experts, conservationists, and so many others committed to putting the Pine Tree State's energy future into the hands of Mainers. We're excited to have you all here tonight, and over 100 people already joined us. I am State Representative Nicole Verhowski from Ellsworth and a member of the legislature's Energy, Utilities, and Technology Committee. Tonight, I'll be your host as we learn about how Maine can be the first state to reach 100% clean energy in an affordable and equitable way. 100% clean energy is something that many of us dream about, but it can be a reality too. We are thrilled that a fantastic group of speakers from Maine and across the US are joining us this evening to share their perspectives and answer your questions about our critical clean energy transition. Please feel free to ask questions through the Q&A function as the summit progresses. We'll have ample time to discuss them at the end. But before we begin the show, I'd like to set the stage just a little bit. So, ranging in size, location, and political leaning, you might be surprised to learn that what these cities have in common. They are the first six jurisdictions in the US to achieve 100% renewable electricity, and they have a lot to teach us. If we want Maine to be the first state to net zero, and I know I do, we'll need to be smart, open-minded, and bold. We'll need to chart a course that's fitting for the temperament of Maine people, competent, hardworking, fiscally prudent, and willing to lead. Electricity will be the key to meeting this moment and addressing climate change head on. We must generate electricity from renewable resources and distribute it via the grid of poles and wires to power our homes, heating and cooling, vehicles, and even industry. This is why our electrical grid is so important and why it's truly alarming that right now it is not ready to meet our needs. If people are to confidently move away from fossil fuels, electricity must be delivered to them reliably and affordably. Right now in Maine, neither condition is being met. We have the most outages in the country and some of the slowest restoration times. For this superlative service, we pay the 10th highest rates. So what about those six communities I mentioned earlier and others like Sacramento that are on their way to 100% clean electricity? What are their utilities doing differently than ours here in Maine? Well, they're focusing on their customers because their customers are also their owners. These customers are demanding 100% clean electricity and their utilities are delivering. Utilities like these are common in America. In fact, one in three Americans gets their electricity from a consumer-owned utility. In Maine, we have 9 consumer-owned utilities. The largest is Eastern Maine Electric Cooperative, which serves a rural area in Down East Maine 2.5 times the size of Rhode Island. Investor-owned utilities like Central Maine Power and Versant are by definition committed to making a profit for their overseas shareholders at the expense of Mainers. This is how we end up with poor service, billing fiascos, and no leadership when it comes to climate. Electric utilities are not like most businesses. They have no competition. As regulated monopolies, they are guaranteed a profit between 8 to 14% by Supreme Court rulings. This high rate of return on investment drives up electricity costs and means that most Maine residents pay 58% more on their bills than they would if they were served by a Maine consumer utility. This to me is legalized extortion. So to recap, we know that electricity is the key to climate action. We know that the grid is the key to getting electrification right. And we also know that our current for-profit utilities are not up for the job and have in fact been standing in our way. So what can we do? We can take ownership of our energy future by buying CMP and Versant at a fair price and replacing them with a locally controlled nonprofit utility that works for Mainers and responds to our clean energy demands. Our speakers tonight will discuss the hows and whys of the effort to own our grid in more detail and provide context for how it fits into America's clean energy transition. First, we'll have the honor and pleasure of hearing from Senators Stacy Brenner and Rick Bennett about the bipartisan movement in Maine for the future of our climate. Senator Stacy Brenner of Scarborough is the Senate Chair of the Joint Standing Committee on Environment and Natural Resources, serving her first term in the Maine legislature. She began her career as a nurse midwife and is an organic farmer and small business owner of Broadturn Farm. She is a board member of Maine Farmland Trust and board president of the Maine Organic Farmers and Gardeners Association. Joining her is Senator Rick Bennett of Oxford, who has served in the Maine legislature for 13 years in both the Senate and House, including as Senate president. Senator Bennett currently serves on the Environment and Natural Resources Committee and the Government Oversight Committee. He is currently president and CEO of Value Edge Advisors and has served on the boards of Maine Conservation Voters, Maine Heritage Policy Center, and Hebron Academy. As a business leader, he has directed or helped the turnarounds of several Maine enterprises, including GWI and Quadi. He received his BA with honors from Harvard University in 1986 and his MBA from the University of Southern Maine in 2000. So, Senators, we are happy to have you this evening and take it away. Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, Representative Grahowski. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you. I met Rick because we are seatmates in committee. We're both on the Environment and Natural Resources Committee. And I tried to convince him that it would be, he's one of my first Republican friends. And so I tried to convince him that it would be a good idea to join me at my book group. And he wasn't really up for it. And so instead, we came up with the idea of having a podcast, which we call Seatmates, where we could cover issues that we agree on and in terms of what the problem is. And then so far, we've really only covered issues where we also agree on the solution. But I do hope that we're headed in the direction of maybe tackling a few of those more thorny issues between parties. But for now, we're holding tight because there's plenty that we agree on.
I think we'll get there, Stacy. We'll find some good stuff. There's an election year coming up.
All right. So I was really excited about getting behind the consumer-owned utility cause because I think that we really need to address the fact that CMP ranks lowest in the J.D. Powers survey 88 electric utilities nationwide year after year were rated as the lowest for reliability and customer service. There's COUs in 49 states and there's 9 of them here in Maine. Ratepayers pay 58% higher in our investor-owned utility than in the COUs in the state. And I wanna make sure that as Maine moves forward, decarbonizing that we're also controlling our energy economy and our energy future. And I believe that that starts with also controlling our grid and our distribution. So that's sort of the way that I came to the issue. Rick, can you tell us, maybe we talked about this in our podcast on this issue, but can you tell us a little bit about your constituents, Nicole and Austin, and their story as it relates to being customers of our investor-owned utility?
Yeah, during our podcast, Nicole Locke and her fiance Austin Healy, are just regular people in Porter, Maine, and they like so many other Mainers, is caught up in this just totally mismanaged company that represents, that CMP is, unhappily, and they were struggling in COVID, thrown out of work. Their electric bill, $100 a month, they were meeting it, and suddenly it goes up to $400 a month. And, they're unhappily, their story is not unique, but CMP threatened to cut them off. In fact, I learned just a couple of weeks ago that, in fact, they did cut them off. And here they are entering the winter, with trying to educate their kids. The kids are trying to do homework. They're trying to put food on the table, and they have to put up with this. And they've complained everywhere. And they finally joined the class action lawsuit that Sumner Lippman is leading in Maine. But unhappily, there are thousands of people in Maine in their position. And I agree with you, Stacy. This is largely because, as Nicole said, the interest here is not serving customers. The interest here is to serve foreign shareholders. Many people don't realize that that CMP and Versant are both owned by foreign governments. And I talked to Republican groups and conservatives who just scratch their heads like everybody else about why is it that our critical infrastructure that on which our future will be based increasingly are owned by foreign companies and foreign governments. In fact, Versant is owned by the city of Calgary. People in Bangor are paying rates on their electric to pave sidewalks in Calgary, Canada. And so we've got a big problem, and it's an issue that I think, it's not a partisan issue. In fact, I know Representative Berry, in leading this issue in the legislature, worked tirelessly to make sure that Republican voices were heard in putting this together. We can get into some of the details, but one of the most striking things is that many of those places that have consumer-owned utilities are, like the whole state of Nebraska, and not exactly what you'd call liberal democratic states. This is a common practice. A third of America is under consumer-owned utilities, and it's very useful in rural areas. So I'm happy to work on this issue, and I know that it, as you said, Stacy, this is about getting control back to the people of Maine, to control their own future.
So electric utilities that are investor-owned don't really have any natural competition. It's a regulated monopoly here in Maine, and it is guaranteed a profit between 8% and 14% by the Supreme Court, which is a relatively high rate of investment. And that's part of what's driving our electricity rates up. And so in the bill that we did pass successfully in the Senate, there was a structure for governance. Rick, could you walk us through what that is?
Yeah, I have to say, I was on the opposition's website today, and the lies start early up on the top of the page. They call this, I have to say, a government-owned, government-run, taxpayer-funded utility. All three are so totally false, they should be ashamed of themselves. The governance structure of this is a not-for-profit private company, and it's the Pine Tree Power Company. It will have its own elected board, elected by the people of Maine, not appointed by the governor, not confirmed by the legislature, and it will be its own entity, like every other consumer-owned utility in Maine and elsewhere. And I think that's really critically important. It's also not seeking any taxpayer funding for the purchase of the assets, nor for the ongoing operation. Utilities across this country, as we will hear, are funded largely by revenue bonds, which are very low interest rate, in contrast to the 8 to 12% return on equity guaranteed to an investor-owned utility. People of Maine will be paying a 3% revenue bond rate. And with that difference between 3 and 12%, we can bring down rates, we can ensure a better run company, and we can modernize our grid.
Wouldn't you guys want Professor Bennett to come to your book group with all your lady friends and drink wine, right? All right. I want to make sure that we don't dominate our 8-minute slot here. I'm pretty sure we've covered some of our most important details around why both of us jumped on board. So we'll pass it back to Representative Grachowski. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thank you both so much, senators. And hopefully you can stick around to the end in case anyone has questions for you. But
and just if you want a longer version, go to seatmatespodcast.com and check out Power for the People episode.
Shameless plugs. I love it. Nice job.
I highly recommend all the episodes of Seatmates personally. It's a go-to for me. So thank you both for joining. Next up, we have two fantastic guests who will be discussing some of the equity considerations and why this really matters for the future of Maine people. We are thrilled to have Ambassador Maulian Dana joining us this evening. She is the Penobscot Nation Tribal Ambassador and former elected tribal council person, co-chair of the Permanent Commission on the Status of Indigenous, Racial, and Tribal Populations, and Climate Council member, as well as co-chair of the Climate Council Subcommittee on Equity. And she will be joined by Ania Wright, who is a leading figure in youth climate activism in Maine. She serves as the youth representative to the Maine Climate Council, works as the grassroots climate organizer for the Sierra Club chapter of Maine, and is a founding member of the youth-led coalition, Maine Youth for Climate Justice, as well as a sitting board member of Maine Climate Action Now. She recently graduated from College of the Atlantic with a BA in human ecology. So Ambassador Dana, Ania, thank you so much for being here, and I will happily turn it over to you to share your perspectives.
Thank you, Representative, so much, and good evening, everyone. Everyone see me and hear me okay? I'm on a different computer. All right, great. great to see you all. And I'm really happy to join tonight and support our power and these great initiatives being brought forward. And I think I just wanted to bring, a perspective as a tribal citizen in the state of Maine and how, you know, the environment and taking care of Mother Earth is really woven into everything we do. It's not something separate. It's not an initiative that we approach in a silo. It's really part of our cultural identity. It's part of our creation stories. It's part of how we run our tribal nations. And growing up on Indian Island, the river, part of our ancestral territory, of course, when I was a child, I wasn't allowed to go swimming in the river. The mills and the paper industry upstream, you know, they would produce a lot of dioxin and pollutants in the river. And this led to some very high cancer rates for our nation and my people. So, you know, from a very young age, I saw how kind of industry and big money and power can be very at odds with the environment and Mother Earth. And you know, as an Indigenous person and, you know, someone in a marginalized group, we internalize that stress, you know, not knowing that it's climate related, not knowing, you know, the parameters around it. We just feel unhealthy. We feel unwell. We suffer from disease. And that continues this lasting legacy of colonization and attempted genocide and oppression. So you think those things are kind of from a bygone era, but when we are dealing with the climate crisis on the front lines, it's woven into our current struggles, and it's very much a reminder of some of those traumatic events our ancestors went through. So the good news about all of that is that there is hope, because, you know, at every single level right now, whether it's grassroots, citizens, state and local and federal governments, everybody has to pay attention to the climate crisis. Everyone, you know, has to, even if they don't agree with it, it's on, you know, it's on the table finally. And that makes me hopeful, as well as, you know, getting this chance to speak from an equity perspective, because we're finally kind of getting it as a collective that we aren't going to make any good progress together unless we're bringing everybody along. And that's something that really, you know, was appealing to me about this project, is the emphasis on bringing everybody along, on really looking at the, you know, looking at alternatives, looking at, you know, resources we can come together to use, and really the focus on the grassroots nature of it and the power of individual people. And as a tribal citizen in Maine, constantly fighting for our sovereignty, you know, these environmental impacts I've talked about, part of the other problem here is that we haven't had our sovereignty restored in the state of Maine, so we're extra powerless at times to deal with these issues. So for me, sovereignty of the individual, of the tribal nation, of the community, of our, you know, together as Mainers, you know, this is really a project that we can unite around and I'm thrilled to be able to add my voice here and really make that plug that as we move forward, we remember those marginalized people and really focus on equity and fairness and holding space for everyone in Maine. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Ambassador Dana. I want to start by actually looping back to something that Senator Bennett was saying about CMP's parent companies being owned by international corporations and other countries. And I actually just had the privilege of attending COP26 in Glasgow in Scotland, which is the UN climate conference that happens every year. And one of the lead sponsors was Iberdrola, which is one of CMP's parent companies. It was just so clear to me there at the COP conference how strong of a hold these large utilities have on our systems at all different levels, at the state level, at the local level, at the national level, and at the international level. As a climate counselor and someone who is very proud of the Maine Won't Wait plan that we came together to pass last year, I feel, so hopeful about the plan that we have and what we want to accomplish and what the people of Maine want. But really, none of that is possible if private utilities, especially like CMP, stand in the way. And I think, as a young person, in this fight against the climate crisis, I'm really quite terrified of what's to come and really feel the urgency of needing to address the climate crisis within the next 7 years. And I really just don't think that's possible if we have CMP. We've seen CMP nullify agreements with solar companies, fight the initial campaign for rooftop solar, they've done many other things to try and stop, renewable energy development. So I really see this campaign as a chance to create transformative change, not only in the state of Maine, but to really start a wave nationally and internationally, showing that really the future is led by the people, and that we really need to, like Ambassador Dana said, put the people at the front lines first, and show our governments that is our priority, and that we really, want to create a world that's led by the people, and that creates a world where everyone can survive and thrive. And I really see that change as possible with this campaign. And so thank you so much for having me. It's a real true honor to be a panelist among these amazing Mainers, and I've really just been so encouraged by this campaign, and how it just gives me so much hope for the future. So thank you for having me, and I think I'll pass it back to Representative Gronowski.
Thank you both so much for sharing the impacts that you see of this effort. I think that really spoke to me, and I'm sure it did to so many of our guests. There's a reason that we're doing this work. So thank you again for joining. I am excited to change a little bit the direction and hear actually from a person who has been working for energy sovereignty in Colorado. So this evening we have joining us Leslie Glustrom. Leslie is a founding member of Clean Energy Action and has served as the Director of Research and Policy for several years, and is now serving as Senior Advisor on the Clean Energy Action Board. Leslie is trained as a biochemist and has spent over 30 years working at the interface of science and society in a variety of roles, including science writing, teaching, policy analysis also. She has spoken through the country on the environmental and economic imperative of accelerating the transition to a world without fossil fuels, and has won many awards for her work. Leslie has written and spoken extensively on the faulty reporting of US coal reserves, and she was also a co-author of the 2011 Harvard study on the true cost accounting of coal. So Leslie, thank you for bringing a perspective from outside of Maine for us this evening, and we're glad you could join in. It looks a little more temperate where you are, perhaps, than where we are.
I realize I should have changed my Zoom picture, but thank you so much, Representative Grohowski, for that kind introduction. I am so thrilled to be here with you all in Maine. Of course, you live in a magnificent state, and this is a magnificent campaign. You have a very strong team. You have a very strong bipartisan team. You have people from all walks of life in the campaign and on the call tonight. And so this is just such an exciting moment for you in Maine, but also for all of us throughout the country. I don't need to remind you probably that the United States is the largest cumulative emitter of greenhouse gases, and we're also the largest per capita emitter. So this really calls for this transformative strategy that you all have evolved into, and you've made so much progress already. You got it through both houses of your legislature. And even when the governor vetoed it, I read her veto letter. I'm like, they have abysmal customer service. And it's really time for Maine to take back their assets. And so even the veto message was a very strong statement about why you're doing the right thing at the right time. I don't need to remind you how, frankly, terrible the climate crisis is, the terrible flooding you have there, the monstrous, hellacious fires and droughts we're having out west. Exactly what you expect is you intensify the water cycle as we heat up the planet, and it's only 2021. So we must move quickly. We must move boldly. We must move courageously. And that's exactly what you're doing. And I am so honored, frankly, to be some small part of what you're doing. You know, Maine, you have a legendary character, and the eyes of the country are on you, and they're going to be even more on you as you move forward. So I thought I would take a few minutes to put this into historical context. For those that already know this history, I apologize, but many probably don't, that this is actually part of a huge struggle that's been going on in the United States for well over a century. I might hold up one book that talks about it, Power Struggle. I wonder if you're going to be able to see that. 100-Year War Over Electricity by two authors named Rudolph and Ridley, all during the big fights over the nuclear plants, written in 1989, so dated. But when you read it and you read page 189, I think it is, about what went on with Central Maine Power at the time and the terrible kind of corruption that was taking place there, you'll go, oh yeah, here we are 30, 40 years later and still seeing the same things. So in 1909, the mayor of Cleveland at the time, Tom Johnson, and Cleveland has public power still now, but it was a huge fight back then. And in 1909, he says, I believe in municipal ownership, same as public ownership or customer ownership, the kind of campaign you're running. I believe in municipal ownership of these monopolies, because if you don't own them, they will in time own you. They will destroy your politics. They will corrupt your institution, and finally destroy your liberties. And I'm seeing a lot of heads nodding on the panel. You're experiencing all of that now, 100 and whatever it is, 11 years later. Then I'll also point you to the famous speech that FDR made in the other Portland, 1932 in Portland, Oregon. And I always am so kind of moved by the story of FDR, a man running the country during the Depression and World War II, paralyzed from the waist down and can barely stand. What a powerful man. And that speech is a very famous speech. If the leaders don't, I didn't find it on your website. So if the leaders don't have it, I'll send it to them. But again, he said, when a community, a city, or a country, or a district is not satisfied with the service rendered or the rates charged by the private utility, and he was talking about electric utilities, it, meaning the community, or in your case, the state, has the undeniable right as one of the functions of government, even though you're going to be setting up this independent kind of system, but this is part of what our obligation. The undeniable right to set up its own, in this case, you have a structure, which I think is very commendable. And you might know that FDR used the phrase that he believed it was like the community, the people having birch rods in the cupboard to use when a mere scolding will no longer work. And certainly you all have tried many kinds of scoldings over many decades, and you've experienced horrific abuses that come with monopolies. Market forces aren't at work. This is why it's often so easy, frankly, to make a bipartisan effort. Because whether you're on the right or the left, you understand that market forces are needed to kind of make things work competitively. So I just absolutely want to cheer you on. In Boulder, we began this process in 2010. We had five elections, 2010, 2011, 2013, 2017, and 2020. We won the first four. We lost the election in 2020 in the middle of the pandemic before we had vaccinations. We had one incredibly intrepid guy named Brad Siegel, who would take our flyers and sterilize them in the oven and then take salad tongs and go down to the park, you know, with practically space gear on to try to hand out our flyers. So although we didn't win, we did have 25,000 people vote with us, which I was really gratified to see. We'll have another chance. We don't have public power, but what we do have is absolutely the attention of our utility, which when I began and other folks that on this call that have been part of this campaign, when we began, our utility was determined to burn coal. We had 200 years of coal. They were going to burn coal forever. They built a coal plant that was going to operate till 2070. I've just spent the day listening, thank goodness, finally, to our utilities commission decide what are we going to do about that stupid coal plant we built. So when we began, it was going to be coal forever. And now we're on a track for somewhere between 80 and 90% carbon reduction by 2030. And we won't stop there. We want it faster and we want it at a lower cost. So we're going to keep going. And I think it's just really important to keep this in mind in terms of movements, you know, whether it's like climbing Everest and, you know, Hillary, we don't know if he made it, but he didn't succeed in climbing Everest. I'm sorry, Mallory. Then 3 decades later, Hillary and Tenzing Norgay made it. Now it's like a traffic jam trying to get to Everest. When you're building a movement, it takes a long time. Susan B. Anthony worked for 60 years to get women the vote and died 10 years before Amendment 19 was ratified. But none of us, I think, would classify her as a failure. So what you're doing is building this very important movement for this very systemic change. And I want to just cheer you on, regardless of what happens. You can read the story about women, the suffrage movement in Maine. Their first petition in the legislature was in 1857. They didn't get the vote till 1920. Do any of us wish they had said, oh, gee, this is too hard, we're just going to quit? No, they just kept building the movement. And that's what you're doing. It's a critically important campaign you're running because electricity is at the foundation of our greenhouse gas emissions. Whatever happens, I'm cheering you on. And I'm also betting on Maine because you have that legendary character. I don't think you're going to give up. Keep going. And thank you so much for letting me be part of this effort. It's a great honor. Thank you.
Are you fed up with utilities that put shareholder profits over decent rates, clean energy, and reliable power? We Mainers at Our Power sure are. That's why we want to replace these foreign-owned for-profit monopolies with the Pine Tree Power Company, a nonprofit utility owned by us customers here in Maine, with a board we get to elect to look out for our interests. Maine already has 9 consumer-owned utilities in 97 towns, from Calais to Kennebunk. They're run locally, and they keep businesses humming and mother warm in the winter. Meantime, towns in CMP in Versant territory have the longest outages in the USA. And not just that, they also charge their customers 58% more than Maine's consumer-owned utilities. With a new consumer-owned utility like the Pine Tree Power Company, we can elect the people who run it, keep the same workers, cut costs, expand high-speed internet, upgrade our ancient grid, and plug in more Maine-made energy. Our Power is all about good old-fashioned Yankee thrift and independence. With a consumer-owned utility, we can take back our power. To find out more, go to www.ourpowermaine.org.
Well, we hope you enjoyed the inspirational message from Leslie, but also a little bit of comedy, because that's part of what keeps this campaign moving is We have to be serious, but we have to have fun too. Next up, I am so excited to bring forward to you all three economists, brilliant Mainers, who are here to talk about why the dollars make sense for Maine. And I saw some questions in the chat about the economics, so I'm so glad that they are here to talk to you, as well as answer your questions later in the evening. So we have Dr. Richard Silkman, who holds a Yale PhD in economics and is nationally recognized expert in the regulation of public utilities, the development of competitive energy markets, and the development, licensing, and operation of power plants, including hydroelectric generating stations. He is the CEO of Competitive Energy Services, a Maine-based energy consulting firm. Also, we are pleased to have Dr. David Vail. He is Adams Catlin Professor of Economics Emeritus and former Director of Environmental Studies at Bowdoin College. He participates in the Citizens Climate Lobby as a member of its Economics Policy Network. He also serves on the Solar Energy Association of Maine Board and the Board of Coastal Enterprises Incorporated Policy Committee, which he formerly chaired. He holds a PhD in economics from Yale University. And finally, Dr. Dick Woodbury, the Honorable Dr. Dick Woodbury, is a program administrator at the National Bureau of Economic Research and a former Maine State Senator. He has also served as a visiting scholar with the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston and has written extensively on tax reform in Maine. He holds a PhD in economics from Harvard University. So we'll let you Harvard and Yale guys duke it out. And thank you for sharing your perspective on why this makes sense for Maine financially.
Well, thanks, Nicole. I'll start and my colleagues can join in. A couple of things to start with. First, with respect to Leslie's presentation, I hope this PowerPoint, our Pine Tree Power, comes into effect well before I die, not 20 years after. So I'd like us to move along in a much faster time frame than some of these previous historical movements. One of the reasons why I think this is such an important issue is that we don't engage in major social transformations unless they're inexpensive, unless we can afford to do it. And what we have in front of us here now is a transformation of our fundamental infrastructure that is in many respects unprecedented in terms of the amount of investment and activity it's going to take to accomplish us moving from a fossil fuel-based economy to a renewable economy. We can do it, but only if we do it smart. And doing it smart means we have to do it inexpensively. You know, looking at decarbonizing the grid, you know, it's probably going to cost us in excess of $50 billion to replace all of our fossil generation with renewable generation. And it's going to cost us, you know, another $10 to $20 billion to expand the electric grid to handle all the cars, heat pumps, and general electrification of our society. And that's an awful lot of money. And if we, just like your own mortgages, I mean, if you can borrow money cheaply, you can afford a bigger house. If you can borrow money cheaply, we can afford this kind of a transformation. And the vehicle for borrowing money more cheaply, that is to be able to make these investments, is a consumer-owned cooperative, is this Maine Pine Tree Power, ultimately authority. So at its heart, independent of all of the environmental concerns and the social justice concerns and the governance concerns, at its heart, like most problems in our society, this is an economic problem. And I think the solution that we're putting forward deals with those economic issues front and center. David, I'm going to turn it over to you. I know you have more to add, and then we'll hear from that college in Cambridge that doesn't quite keep up with Connecticut.
Bula bula. Dr. Silkman is our group's energy expert. My research and advising work over many decades have focused on development strategies for rural Maine. What I'd like to do in my couple of minutes is make three points about a special way that Pine Tree Power will contribute to rural economic revitalization and at the same time to the state's climate goals. First point is that it's an explicit part of the Pine Tree Power mission, set out in LD 1708, the bill passed by the legislature, quote, to improve the state's internet connectivity through more affordable access to utility poles and other infrastructure in unserved or underserved areas. Universal broadband, of course, is a top priority of Maine's Jobs and Recovery Plan and of the newly created Maine Connectivity Authority. Second point is that my research and work by lots of others makes it very clear that high-speed internet is critical for virtually every part of the rural economy, from healthcare to tourism. And the third point is that universal broadband coverage is not only economically crucial, but it will make a significant contribution to Maine's climate strategy. Think about remote work opportunities. Think about telehealth services. Think about many different kinds of distance learning programs. All of those have been crucial for us to survive, especially for rural Maine to survive the ongoing pandemic. What I would stress is that all of these cut down on vehicle travel and carbon emissions. So even though most of our discussion is about other issues directly related to electrification, I think we should keep in mind that Pine Tree Power's mission also extends to a very high priority goal, and that is universal broadband connectivity. Dick, over to you.
All right, nice to be with you. I have three categories of reasons that I feel so strongly about this referendum. The first is the financial one. Rich gave some outline of the incredible investment that needs to happen in our grid. And it needs to happen because, first of all, we're going to be using a lot more electricity. But second of all, the way we're going to be making it is different locations. It's going to be much more decentralized in terms of the community and home solar and so forth. It's a grid that needs some bi-directionality to it. It's a very different grid than what we have now. And it's going to cost a lot of money to transform it to what it needs to be. And so the pure financial argument is you can finance this at 2 or 3% with these tax-exempt revenue bonds that we're eligible to issue as a consumer-owned utility, or you finance it with 10 to 12% interest rates that are required to be paid if it's an investor-owned utility like CMP. And those differences in interest rates compound over the full life in which you're paying for this project. So the difference is really enormous, and you know, and quite frankly, maybe the difference between feasible and not feasible in terms of getting to the very ambitious climate goals that we have in mind. My second category is related, which is that the investor-owned utility that owns the current grid has incentives to continue to use the grid the way it is, more than to transform it what it needs to become. And that's why we've run into some of the policy opposition to things like net metering, to allowing these new small producers to get access to the grid, and wanting to charge, you know, additional amounts of money for all of these additional things that they feel they need to do to make this transformation. So not only do we have sort of this financial issue, if this becomes a consumer-owned utility, you've got the utility itself wanting to participate with the public in making the transformation that has to happen. As an investor-owned utility, there's much more of a blockage to try to prevent what needs to happen from happening. The third category is just you expect a public utility to really have some public citizenship and to actually be working in the public interest. And I just can't believe how consistently these companies appear not to do that, to not be operating at some level in the public interest. And I see any one of these three reasons as being sufficient for me to believe this this referendum is a good idea, this change to a consumer-owned utility is a good idea, and put the three together, and it's just a complete non-brainer, a no-brainer in my view. So great to be with you, and those are my thoughts.
Thank you so much. Really appreciate all of your perspective, and I am imagining that there will be some questions for our brain trust here. So hopefully you can put those in the chat and we will come back to them shortly. I am pleased to recognize another guest greeting us from the national stage, John Farrell, to talk about the outlook on clean energy nationally. John is the co-director of the Institute for Local Self-Reliance and directs the Energy Democracy Initiative. Widely known as the guru of distributed energy, he has received accolades for his vivid illustrations of the economic and environmental benefits of local ownership of decentralized renewable energy. John authored Energy Self-Reliant States, a state-by-state atlas of renewable energy potential highlighted in the New York Times, showing that most states don't need to look outside their borders to meet their own electricity needs. So thank you, John, for being with us this evening.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. I think I always think it's useful for people in talking about these issues of utility ownership and of our clean energy future to think about the fact that the rules for the electricity system are ones, they're public rules. Like 100 years ago, even a little more than 100 years ago, we decided to structure our utility system in a particular way. And we've tinkered at the edges, but it's largely the same. And so when I think about the outcomes that we get, and I just heard someone talking about kind of the dissatisfaction that so many Mainers have with the utility companies, it's important to understand that utility executives are acting very rationally based on the rules that they have in place for them, even if it's not always ethically or morally the right thing. So you don't get the public interest in part because the rules aren't set up very well for them to provide it. And it's hard to design rules that do that when the competing pressure is always to fulfill that legal obligation to shareholders. What we have seen, though, is no matter what the rules of the general system are, we've always found innovations and ways to do this. So 100 years ago, when rural Americans were left behind in the access in getting access to electricity by the investor-owned utility companies who didn't see an advantage in serving them, the federal government stepped in and helped people to help themselves, to raise their own capital in rural communities and string wires and to get electricity. And now there's all sorts of distributed energy things. Rooftop solar, community solar are giving Americans really unprecedented choices about where they can get their energy from, in the same way that initially having electricity access provided access to so many things like refrigerators or home appliances or things that people never imagined being able to use before. And unfortunately, we find that the utility companies, very comfortable in having decision-making power over the electricity system, are often opposed to those things. There's a fight raging right now. It's all over my social media feed as someone who follows energy policy stuff about in California, how the Public Utilities Commission there is at the behest of the utilities looking at reducing compensation for solar producers. Even though those solar producers have invested as much money collectively, there are 1.3 million people in California that have made an investment, a home and business owners, to put solar, clean energy onto the grid on behalf of using their own money. And that's something like $35 to $40 billion of investment they've made in California's electricity system, which is equal to the market cap of the entire utility company, Pacific Gas and Electric, one of the biggest in that state. And so we have to take advantage of that. We need a utility structure. We need rules for the system and a utility structure that allows us to capture that value instead of feeling like we're constantly in tension with the utility company that runs our grid system. And so I am just thrilled that the conversation in Maine and in other places has gotten to this point where we are actively talking about how do we structure that system that makes more rational sense, that will get the utility company to act in the public interest, to align its incentives and values. We do a lot, ILSR has done a lot of coverage of consumer-owned utilities. We actually just published a terrific interview with Luis Reyes from the Kit Carson Electric Cooperative in New Mexico. They talk about a similar monopoly fight. They were getting their electricity from a larger cooperative, and it was tying them down. It was saying, you can't generate your own energy. We're really heavily invested in coal. We don't want you to leave. Your rates are rising. So the service was very poor quality. And they've decided to leave. They decided to leave that relationship So they would be free to invest in the thing that they saw as most valuable, which is solar locally in the communities around Taos, New Mexico, many smaller solar projects. So there'd be economic benefits to be spread around. So the interview is just a great story to highlight this broader national movement toward decentralizing the power in the electricity system, allowing people to choose for themselves, empowering consumers, and bringing more democracy into the decision-making in our utility system.
Thank you so much, John, for sharing your perspective and for news from around the country. We get very focused. I get very focused on what's happening here and how I can affect change. And it's really encouraging to hear about others who are doing the same, because I think that's how we make this work nationally and globally. So thank you again for joining us. Next, I'm pleased to introduce an artist to share with us a piece to round out our evening. Jess Cooper is a young mother, dancer, musician, artist, community organizer, and an avid environmental advocate. And she incorporates her art into everything she does. She centers her work in alignment with organizations and projects that help create thriving environments for current and future generations to live, work, and play in. She is driven by strengthening connections in her community and carries out this work as executive director of a creative nonprofit called Creative Norway that provides low-cost creative spaces, mentorships, and funding for creative classes and projects for youth and adults. She also works at the Fair Share Food Co-op, where she finds joy in the day-to-day interactions with a huge and growing community of member owners and works to promote the cooperative model that she believes is essential in building resilient communities. Her hope is that through creative expression, value-centered work, cooperative education, and promoting consumer ownership, she can continue to lend support in the movement for a stable climate and thriving local communities. So thank you, Jess. We look forward to seeing you this evening.
Thank you for that introduction, Nicole, and thank you all for having me. I'm really excited to be back listening to you all about the consumer and utility. What comes up for me as a young mother and the issue of tackling climate change and how we can start doing this on a local level, I keep coming back to how to take these large ideas like a consumer and utility and process them into bite-sized bits. And it always brings me back to how important it is to stay curious. So when I was asked to use art to speak to you all, I chose to write about how I'm staying curious about the consumer and utility, and I invite you all to do the same. So I wrote a little piece called Consider the Consumer. Consider this, the first arc of light powered by wire and magnet, then the first one that was ever attached to a switch. How one by one, every room and building and city was lit. How one day, all at once, through electricity, sound could transmit. How telegraph letters could appear to us through those sounds of a beep or a click. And then how lives and communities and science evolved with the idea of a current. Consider the source of life, the water that sustains. Hydropower brought us to coal, brought us to gas, brought us to atomic power and nuclear reactor. And then once things became clear that our methods couldn't satisfy the needs of the masses, we looked back again to the source, to water, to sun, to wind, to earth. Consider our grandparents, their experience shaped and formed by the slowness of the world, then exploding of new ideas revolutionizing their work. They bear stories from their parents of what life was like before this all unfurled. Consider now, fast, cash, big blast through mountain pass, frack to reach this gas, burn to make it all turn until we finally learn. And then, wind and sun to make it all run. We know something else can be done. Consider future generations. Will they wonder why we did what we did? Will they lament the way we tore apart communities and ecology for profit? Will we tell them it wasn't our fault, even though there were alternatives? Will they remember that there was a shifting from those who could no longer sit and watch their neighbors robbed of every cent while trying to power their homes and their lives and raise the children that became the future generations? Consider you, a single person, a human in an ocean of other beings, with the ability to touch many hundreds in a lifetime. You, the consumer, the user who can at any time also be the chooser of what's right. Will you use your voice and your choice to repair, to write new history for the future generations and the youth currently drowning in despair of an earth left to them in a state that is beyond unfair? Will you uplift and bring forth something better than what's currently there? Consider you, raising and nurturing these youth with care, for them to find out that they can own a piece of something they'll always need, a part of a grid we all share. So as a young person, a mother, a Mainer, a consumer, as a human, I invite you, consider your impact, consider what you need, consider what you use, consider the source, consider consumption, consider ownership, consider the youth, consider your chance to stand in your power, to stand up and choose. A clean energy future, shining a light for the way through to Maine's liberation from for-profit utilities, long overdue.
Thank you so much, Jess. I am clapping out loud for all of those of you who cannot have that opportunity, but I hope that you are clapping it in your homes and sitting with that message. Thank you for being with us.